Hi everyone, and welcome to another episode of Long COVID on the Short, where today we're going to be talking about the prevalence of long COVID. Prevalence is one of the topics that draws the fiercest types of discussions. And why? Because there's not a single unique answer to this. It depends on the definition. Are we talking about any type of persisting symptoms after COVID-19 infection, or are we talking about more severe types of symptoms that persist after a COVID infection? The way we consider this problem will completely change our answer. Let's try to think of 10,000 people getting infected with COVID-19. What happens to them now? According to academic research, from 25 to 30% of these people, that is 3,000 out of the 10,000 that were infected, are going to have persistent symptoms after their infection. The thing is that in these persistent symptoms, we will have minor things, such as a persistent cough for a while or feeling a little bit more tired for 3 months, to some of the very serious symptoms that persist over a long time that I described on the previous video. Should all of this be considered long COVID? I leave it as an open question for now. If we look at socioeconomic data, it paints a very different picture. From 2 to 4% develop long COVID. That's 400 out of the 10,000 people that were infected. And it's quite a different number from before. Now, why is that difference? Socioeconomic data is much more sensitive to effects that impact your ability to work, your ability to perform in the job market. So for you to actually have a disease that impacts your amount of work, you actually already need to be quite in the more severe end of the spectrum. Now for me here, we have the opposite problem. I think long COVID is much more than just the very severe end of the spectrum. And at this point, I would refer you to the work of Katie Back. She's one of the first people that tried to tackle this subject. And in my opinion, she did it extremely well. And her research points to a number closer to 10% of the people developing long COVID that ends up having a moderate to severe impact on their daily life. But always remember that all of this happens in a spectrum of severity. So what we know is that from 2 to 4% develop a quite severe type of long COVID, then up to 10% people develop a type of long COVID which has a moderate to severe impact on your daily living, and then perhaps from 10 to 25 or 30% people develop persistent symptoms that don't necessarily have a big impact in their daily life. Now you might be thinking, Herbert, I've heard that it's much more common to develop long COVID after hospitalization. Why aren't you saying this? Well, for sure that's true. According to this study, the probability of developing long COVID after hospitalization is 50%. That's much higher than the probabilities we were discussing before. While this is true percentage-wise, the very interesting thing is to look at the raw numbers. So let's take a second look at our 10,000 people that were infected with COVID. The general probability of being hospitalized with COVID is around 0.1%. Out of these, 10 will be hospitalized, 0.1%. Out of those 10, 50%, which means 5, will develop long COVID. This leaves us with 9,900 patients that had a somewhat mild, maybe a bit more serious or completely asymptomatic infection. Out of these, if we take the most conservative estimate of 2%, then 198 people will develop long COVID. That's already exceedingly higher from the 5 we had that were hospitalized. Now, if we take a more realistic percentage, let's say 10%, that means that 990 out of these 10,000 will develop long COVID after a mild infection. That is so much higher than the amount of people that developed long COVID and were hospitalized. So hopefully you see now why the vast majority of long COVID cases comes from mild infections, even if it's more likely to have long COVID after hospitalization. It's interesting, right? Now, what about vaccines? You might think that they protect you from getting long COVID. Well, they do, but only very little. Our best research shows that it only reduces the risk of getting long COVID by around 15%. On the more positive note, research also shows that it seems to protect mostly from a cluster of symptoms that are neurological symptoms, but not against those that are musculoskeletal, like fatigue. Now, another interesting aspect I wanted to quickly tackle is recovery. No one can actually tell you how long it takes to recover from long COVID. That is because if you look at the studies, they mention up to 1 year, up to 2 years, but in reality, if you're 2 years in a pandemic and you have studies that have a duration of 2 years, then you actually don't know if it only lasts 2 years. You just know that it can last up to 2 years and it might continue. The good news around this is that it does seem that the recovery is not necessarily always correlated to your degree of severity. I personally know of someone severe who recovered very fast, and I know other people who had minor symptoms which took longer. This also seems to reflect the experience of the online patient community and some of what we know in academic journals. Now, aside from long COVID, there's only one more thing that I would like to talk about in terms of prevalence, and those are post-COVID effects that don't necessarily translate into ongoing symptoms. So what am I talking about? For example, earlier this year, it was found that Epstein-Barr, the virus that causes mononucleosis, increases the chances of having multiple sclerosis by 32 times. This even when controlling for other viruses. For COVID, we don't know exactly what these consequences might be. However, current research already seems to indicate that the burden of heart disease, heart attack, coagulation problems, and development of neurological and psychiatric condition increases after a COVID-19 infection, even without the development of long COVID. Now, I just want to say that absolutely no one is telling you that because you had COVID, you will have a disorder, okay? No one is saying this. However, at a society level, we do seem to see a significant increase in the development of these diseases due to COVID-19 infection. Some have also hypothesized potential effects on our immune system and anecdotally linked it to why everyone seems to be sick these days. However, this last part does need more evidence that only time can provide or deny. What I am most convinced of, and that I have seen academically, in interviews with clinical cardiologists, and even in personal interactions with these medical professionals, is that indeed, at a society level, we will see an increase in vascular and heart-related conditions, because it does seem that COVID is as much of a vascular disease as it is a respiratory one, if not more, and that in particular, it really likes to attack the endothelium, which is the inner lining of your blood vessels. And so in sum, to me, these are some of the scariest aspects of viruses, their unknown and lingering after effects. For those of you who might be more interested, I also leave down below some references on other associations we are seeing between COVID-19 infection and health-related outcomes. So today we talked about the prevalence of long COVID. I hope you liked this video. And if you find these informative, make sure to stick around for the next videos where we're gonna start talking about the actual research hypothesis behind the causes of long COVID, with the first one being microclots. So I hope to see you there, and as always, stay safe, and if you're on this boat, I hope your recovery is steady, if not quick.